Good evening, everyone, and hopefully everyone is having a blessed Wednesday. Today is July 17th, and we are in store for unpacking our next reality, which is invitation, and how the book of Acts, which is the church and the Holy Spirit, intertwines with the invitation of our third reality. So with that, let us have our devotional period. I'll be reading scripture from Luke chapter 6, verses 12 through 16. And I'll be reading from the NIV. On one of those days, Jesus went out to a mountainside to pray and spent the night praying to God. When morning came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also designated apostles. Simon, who he named Peter, his brother Andrew, James, John, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, who was called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. Let us pray. Lord, we just come to say one more time, come to you in your presence to say thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for this gift of life that you have given us to give you all praise, glory, and honor. Lord, I ask that you go with before us as we continue to unpack and experiencing you, God, through your book, through your Bible and your word, the book of Acts, Lord, as we continue to experience more of you as we learn the third reality of invitation. Lord, I ask that you go with the facilitator, Lord. Lord, remove self out of the way and let your Holy Spirit move and guide him, Lord, as he unpacks this next reality, Lord. Lord, I ask that you go with each and every one of us, that our hearts may be open to hear from you, God, as we learn more and more about you. Lord, I ask that you continue to bless this congregation, continue to bless our pastor as we move forward in his vision. And all these things I ask in your son, Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Without further ado, I will turn it over to Deacon Farmer. So he switched it up this time when we did the actual experiencing God, the seven realities, it did crisis of belief, but he's going to be bringing us invitation this week, and it will also depict pastor's sermon a couple of weeks ago. So with that, Tony Farmer, it's in your hands.
Thank you. And welcome everybody to tonight's Bible study. As soon as I can get this thing straight. There we go. All right. So I'm so excited to be able to bring reality number three, invitation, this evening. And before we do that, I'm just going to do a really quick review. Minister Jeffrey Frost did relationship last week, and he did such a phenomenal job. I only hope that I can do half as well as he did, but he does a such phenomenal job. And, you know, he, you know, remains a big brother in ministry. So I appreciate him and appreciate, you know, the study and the effort he put into bringing that word to you all. So last week, we had our study based on Pastor's sermon, Don't Hold Back. And those scriptures came from Acts, the fifth chapter, verses 1 through 10. We learned about Ananias and Sapphira. We learned about honoring our commitments to God. And in Ananias and Sapphira's case, we also learned the circumstances, repercussions of not honoring our commitments to God. We talked about honoring our commitments to each other and what that looks like. We talked about what God expects from each one of us. And again, we talked about the circumstances of allowing God to come in and dictate your actions. So tonight, we're going to talk about invitation, what it is to be invited by God to become involved with him in his work. And I want to throw some thoughts out. We're going to start our engagement real early, right? And I'm going to go to Reverend Daffin. Reverend Daffin, if you could come off of mute and tell me, how does a person earn a spot on an invitation list? You're planning for a party, you're planning for a wedding, you're planning for an event. How do you determine Who makes it onto the invitation list?
The relationship, brother. Deacon Tony Form, it I think it depends on the relationship with the persons that are invited into or to the event or what have you. So I think it's based on your relationship with the individual, because 9 times out of 10, you don't necessarily invite someone that you're not necessarily have a relationship with or some type of dealings with those individuals. So I think it's based on the relationship.
So, Reverend Daphne, I've heard you correctly. In order to make an invitation, to earn a spot on an invitation list, you got to establish a relationship first. I got to know who you are. I got to understand what your character is. I have to believe that you're going to come in and be in a celebrative spirit. I have to believe that you're going to come in and add something instead of take something away from me. Did I misunderstand? Did I leave anything out?
You did misunderstand absolutely, because we would not want someone to come to the event or what have you and then become out of order and act unseemly. Because if we're having a fellowship or some type of event that's joyous or what have you, you wouldn't want someone to come that would cause distraction. So you would definitely want to invite someone that you would know how to con they would know how to conduct themselves and be as they should be at the event. So relationship, and that's what it's
Love
all
it.
about, a relationship.
I love it. Thank you, Reverend Daphne. Janine, if you could come off of mute and tell me not only what you feel, but how you respond when you receive an invitation. What are some things that come to mind when you receive an invitation?
So for me, it's where it's going to be, who is the invitation coming from, the time of the invitation, and what is it really about? I need to know all of the details to know if I really want to be in that place for that situation.
So let me just make sure I'm understanding you correctly. Despite the relationship that you have with the person who sent you the invitation, you still need to know the what, the who, the where, and who else is going to be there in
Yeah,
order
and
for you
everything
to
that's gonna be
in
going
order
on.
for you to decide if you're going to accept the invitation or not.
Yes. Because even though sometimes people or you have certain relationships have different levels. Sometimes they shift. You can have a relationship shift where you still have some type of dealings with a person, but maybe it's not in that realm that you were in before. So at that point, you have to pick and choose and be very careful where you go, what you do, or what's going on. You just got to be mindful at times.
And so, thank you, Sister Janine. So, Sister Liston B, yes, I remembered your name. I'm not going to forget it moving forward. Sister Liston B, let me ask you, when you have sent out invitations to events that you have sponsored or that you were a part of, what were your expectations of the people that you sent an invitation to? Can you recall that?
I need to know something about the people that I'm getting myself involved with before I can come together to do anything. If I don't know you, haven't heard of you, and just received an invitation, I will have to find out something about you enough to put me comfortable in your company or with other people that might be associated with you.
Now, what if you were the one sending the invitations? What if you put your list together, you know everybody, you know who you want to be there to celebrate with you, and you send those invitations out? What are you expecting to get back?
I would be, if it were me, sending out the invitation. I would pick the people that I send them out to, knowing something about them, especially whether they are saved or which they are members of the church or what type of personality that they have before I would even send the invitation.
And most invitations have a response that you give, a yes or a no. They have what's called an RSVP. Is that right? Am I getting that right?
Yes.
And the RSVP tells you what?
They received it. They have accepted it.
And or not.
Yes, either they did or didn't accept it. Yes, you're right.
So let me just run through this real quick. In order for somebody to get on an invitation list that depends on a relationship. Sister Janine gave us a new word, a relationship. Sometimes, even though you know the person who sent you an invitation, you got to evaluate what that relationship is to now, what it is today, and whether or not, and how you want to respond to that. And then when we look at our expectations, we kind of expect people to say yes, right? We need to know, you know, how many to prepare for. We need to know what kind of atmosphere we're going to have. We need to know if there's any special arrangements we have to make. There's some information we are expecting back. Did I get all that right?
You got that right.
All right. Okay. So, Brother Jay Ross, I'm going to invite you to help me with this evening's study by reading Acts, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 7. Now, Brother Jay, I want you to read this, and then I want you to tell me if it has any special meaning to you.
Okay. Acts 6, starting at verse 1. And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrew, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, is it not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables? Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you 7 men of honest report, full of Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over the business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the same pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, and Procurius, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Pomerius, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch, whom they set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. This is part of what we went through as being deacons. That was one of our studies. One of my questions was, how did you come about choosing us 6 at the time as to be deacons? And we was taken to Acts 6. 1 through 7. This is how we went about. We looked among our congregation for some men that we thought probably would suit the calling of being deacons. And you 6 were chosen from our pastors and the deacon board and the brethren that put our names in the hat. You 6 came out. Awesome. This also, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, it also reminds me of, you never know who's watching you in the church. Because I think the 6 of us were thinking, we were asking the same question among ourselves is, what do we do or what have we been doing? We never knew that we were being looked at, thought of, or even groomed and preparing us for the position of being deacons.
Awesome, awesome. Now, Sister Quinnipia, let me ask you. You and I, we have these years of experience in human resources, and oftentimes, as a human resources professional, we're asked to put together a job description. when you read Acts 6, 1 through 7, how does it read to you? It reads to me like a job description. What about you?
It reads to me as a job description, but it also seems to single out those types of attributes that are going to be looked upon so that you can clearly differentiate between one person or another. It wasn't that in this particular group, there were not people who did not love God or whatever else, but these are people, the criteria was they needed to be full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. So when you put those qualifiers in there, it makes it easier to say what a person does and does not do, or what they have or may not have.
Now, Sister Cornethia, if you think about some of the things that you and I have had to encounter in our career, this list seems short. Usually, you got to have however many degrees, you got to have, you know, so many years of experience, you got to have IEEE, you got to have Java, and I know I'm dating myself, you got to have this script and that script, you have to understand AI. This one has three qualifications. Full of the Holy Ghost, honest report, and wisdom. Full of the Holy Ghost, that seems simple.
But I think that you and I both know we have brought on people that have more degrees than a thermometer, and they have not been able to produce.
I'm keeping that one. Thank you for that. I'm keeping it. More degrees than a thermometer. Sister Vivian Reed, what do you think that the seven thought about when they were selected? Sister Reed, you there? Okay. How about Deacon Adebo? What do you think went on in the minds of these seven men when they were selected to do this work?
Well, I mean, just like Deacon Ross shared, it was something they weren't expecting. It was new to them, because prior to that time, I'm not a theologian, so I can't tell if the synagogues had that tradition of appointing, you know, elders in the mold of what had just been done. So they will be quite unsure of what they're supposed to be, you know, because of the uniqueness of this. So it comes with apprehension, some level of nervousness, perhaps. And I think I found myself in similar situations in the past. When you find yourself in leadership positions that you probably you weren't thinking about, and you see the responsibility, and it could be overwhelming sometimes. So I feel some of them would have gone through those emotions.
Let's talk about others who have been called to or invited to be in the service of God. Let's talk about that a little bit. And one of the things that I came across as I was in my study was that God often doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called, which means that if God calls us and invites us into his work, sometimes we don't always trust that we are qualified for what God is asking us to do. And it causes us hesitation. It causes doubt. It causes lack of confidence. But we've got some examples, some biblical examples of how people were impacted in the scriptures. So when God called Moses, Moses had something to say about it. Reuben, let me ask you, can you recall what Moses' response was when God called him to conduct the unconditional release of the Israelites out of Egypt. Can you recall what his initial reaction was?
Yeah, I think the first thing Moses said, he stuttered and he said, I'm slow at speech. Mm-hmm. And I guess he's almost questioning, are you sure you want me? But I remember the speech part specifically that he said he was slow at speech.
How many times have you been called on to do something and the first thing that came to your mind is, why me?
Sometimes.
And what did it take to you for you to get from why me to okay?
Usually I ask myself, why not me? And then if there is some good that I could offer, then it's me.
Is that an easy transition?
Oh yeah, for me it is. It's like after you get over the initial ask, then you decide, well, if that's the call, then that's the call, and you go with it.
Okay. All right. Appreciate you. Now, with David, if I remember correctly, David's confidence in the call wasn't the question. It was his father's confidence in David that was the question. Reverend Frost, keep me straight on that. When David was faced with the fight, he jumped in immediately. It seemed that everybody else doubted him. So how do you deal with being called and invited into the service of God and everybody else is doubting you? You know what God has called you to do, but everybody else got something to say about it. How you deal with that?
Oh, that is really deep. That's a deep question. I guess what Reuben was saying, you at some point you have to go with it because you may not see yourself qualified either. And, you know, there may not be anyone to coach you into position, but you know that God is calling you. So you move forward, you know, and this causes you to depend solely on God. And I think that's what happened with, you know, with backtracking to Moses again is, you know, Moses didn't see himself in that position, but God had already pre-qualified him. And so with David, I think, or not being recognized by his peers, I think his peers were conditioned to look for a certain criteria when God says, that's not what I want, you know, and he put this other person in place that didn't fit what man thought would be there. So that's a really hard question to answer specifically, but I say with myself, I said, you just have to step forward in faith.
And David demonstrated faith, even though in every situation, when he was selected to be God's king, when he came before everybody else doubted, everybody. And yet David was strong enough of faith to keep moving forward. Find that interesting. I wonder what y'all think. Sister Falsaru, tell me what you know about Gideon. What comes to mind when you hear Gideon?
Gideon wanted to have proof that
my Lord
things were that he was the one that was called, and asked Lord, if you do this and do that, I'll know it's you. Then he'll say, well, dear Lord, if you do this and do that, I'll know it's you. So, but God was very patient. He kept working with him until he finally showed him, this is me and this is what you're supposed to do.
So sometimes we're called and it's why me?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we're called and it's everybody else is hating and doubting. And what I hear you saying is, in Gideon's case, he was called, but he needed continuous proof that uh-huh. God was the one giving him the assignment.
That's right.
And yet God gave him grace.
Yes.
And answered every call.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
My Lord. Okay. All right, Sister Lefwich, I'm coming to you. You ready? Come on off mute.
Ready?
Are you ready? So tell me what you remember about Esther.
I think that Esther had the strength and knowledge of what it was that God was calling her to do. And as a result of that, she took the risk and came out victoriously.
I love the quote in Esther. And you really have to kind of process what she mm-hmm. might have been thinking. She said, if I die, I die. Esther, mm-hmm. Esther was mm-hmm. selected to be one of the individuals, one of the women to be considered to be queen, to be prepared and be groomed to be queen, but was only allowed in the king's presence upon request. In order to save her mm-hmm. uncle and her people, she had to break that mm-hmm. rule. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to lay some things on your mind in terms of what happens when we are invited into this work that God has for us to do, into the work of spreading the gospel, into the work of saving souls, into the work of bringing people closer to Him, into the work of providing for people who have less than we have, to do missions, you know, both locally and internationally. When God calls, I just wanted us to have some thought process as to what can happen and to give you examples from a biblical perspective of what happened to these individuals we've been reading about all these years. Let me pause and ask if there's any questions, any thoughts, any from anybody, any thoughts, questions based on what we've gone over so far.
Excuse me, Deacon Farmer, I just want to commend you in the way that you put these examples together, because it made me look at each one of them maybe from a different perspective. They got the invitation, mm-hmm. but what did they all do? They all did something different with that invitation instead of immediately saying, here I am, I'm ready. Okay, so but thank you mm-hmm. so for presenting each one of this to us.
Bless you, bless you.
Hi, I have a comment and perhaps I need help. When you asked about the expectations, the first mm-hmm. thing that I thought about is not having any expectations, because I think that having expectations can get you in, at least me, I'm going to just talk about me, for it can get me into trouble having certain expectations.
That's interesting. I think that personally, when I make plans and try to anticipate what God wants from me, I am confident that God laughs at me every time. I'm confident that my expectations aren't lofty enough. They aren't big enough to accommodate what God has in store for me. Mm-hmm. And so I think what you said is so important, that when God calls us, when He invites us into service, to suspend our expectations, to suspend what we believe can be done, and lean on our faith in Him and trust that all we need to do is be pointed in the right direction, is to be given our instruction and to move according to His will, not ours.
Thank you.
Excellent point. Thank you so much. Anybody else?
Not
me. Well, okay, go ahead.
Brother Glenn.
No, go ahead. I'll let you.
No, I was thinking when I saw that question, because for me, I think I mentioned when we were talking that if I am extending an invitation, excuse me, I am expecting for people to come and to conduct themselves in a presentable way. I am not expecting for them to carry off my furniture or my whatever else. You know, I want them to really and truly enjoy themselves. If I go somewhere, I accept an invitation, I don't expect for me to show up
and I'm needing to now man the grill or go get a bag of ice, or, you know, because you did not ask me, you know, that was a part of the invitation, you know, so I'm expecting whatever's on the invitation is what I'm going to do. Now, if God calls me, I expect that God is going to hold my hand. You know, he's going to walk right beside me. You know, he may not lay out everything point blank as it relates to what I can expect along the way, but I can expect that whatever it is, as long as I'm walking and I'm in accordance with his will, that he is going to handle it. He's going to manage it. He's going to mitigate it. He's going to do whatever needs to be done to ensure that whatever assignment he's given me, that it comes out victorious.
Amen. Amen. Brother Glenn.
Well, I'm going to say that I guess I've had a different journey than most of you. My journey and invitation with God has been, he puts you in a situation. When I look back, okay, now I'm not going to go or everything. When I look back, he caused some things to happen in my life that I thought were just awful, you know, and I didn't know what was going on. But when I look back, there were things that were coming up in my life that he gave me the wherewithal or the experience or the ability, let's put it that way, to respond to that call. I mean, and I got to tell you, in most cases, he didn't give me a chance. You know, I'm not trying to preach to you, but I'm much older than you guys, and I can tell you things that he did, and I thought, oh my gosh, you know, what's going on? Well, I now go back and I look at those things, and if he hadn't done that, if he hadn't prepared me, I wouldn't have been able to do it. And I look at Moses, he gave him Aaron, his brother. He said, you can't, God was put out with Moses. He didn't really want to do it, but God did it. He said, well, you can't speak. I'll give you Aaron, who can. Now that came back on Aaron, because when Moses got in trouble, he got Aaron in trouble too, because of that, you know. Anyway, so it comes with an obligation that God takes care of. You know, he doesn't choose us because we are capable. I don't know why he chooses us. I really don't. But he has, it's like I think the minister said, God calls you because he knew you before you were ever conceived in your mother's womb. And I believe that. You know, he knows what he wants you to do. And I mean, I could tell you all kinds of stuff, but I won't take the time. But
dig in for
him. I'm sorry, what?
Can I?
I'm sorry. Anyway, that's what I'm saying. God calls you and he knows what he wants you to do, and he makes sure that you do it.
Digging Farmer, I was more referring to my expectations of others.
Say more.
No, just, I mean, you can have expectations of others that can get you in trouble, I feel like. At least it has, I feel like, in some areas of my life, expecting someone to be a certain way and that not being the case, or vice versa.
I like
it. I was referring to your initial question about inviting people and having, what do you expect of your guests?
Oh, I got you. I understand. Yeah, expectations either way. Either, I would say, expectations horizontally or vertically. My wife and I, it's interesting, my wife and I were having this conversation this morning about accountability and what that means to us, and how we experience it, and you know how we observe other people receive it or not. And so it's interesting how sometimes we fall, our expectations fall short of what God has in store for us. But to your point, our expectations are also impacted by not only other people, but other people's expectations of us.
Right.
So that's heavy no matter how you cut it. That's good stuff.
Can I say something?
Please, yes.
Yeah, sometimes, like in life, people will always say something, you know, I don't know whether it's me, but you don't really depend most of the time on what people say, because whatever you do, people are going to have something to say about it, you know. I don't know whether it's me, but as I've gotten older, people will always say something. So I don't rely too much on, other people's expectations. If I know within me that I'm doing the right thing and I feel that is what God has called me to do, I don't really pay too much attention to what people expect of me. You know, it's what God expects of me. And if I'm doing something right, I don't pay attention too much to other people's expectations, honestly. Maybe it's me.
Now, Sister Aputa, I'm glad you mentioned that, because it takes my mind back to what Reverend Daphne talked about earlier, and that is relationship. When God invites me to do something, my relationship with him dictates that I have to move forward with the invitation. I have to accept the invitation. I have to respond to the invitation. I have to act on the invitation. My relationship with God dictates how, when, and how quickly I do it. My relationship with God guides me on understanding that what I need to understand to do what it is that he has invited me to do. And sometimes we get so hung up on our other relationships and how those things impact us that we don't have enough energy to honor the relationship we're supposed to be creating with God. And that can be derailing from time to time.
Yeah, because, you know, all the Bible, if you look at Joshua 1, and especially Isaiah 41:10, he says, do not fear, for I'm with you. And he gives you the courage that you need to go on. All this, like Isaiah 41, so do not fear, for I am with you. I am by your God. I will strengthen you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. There's so many passages in the Bible that he gives us to empower us and give us courage in what we're doing. Because even your own family, that my experience, your family will turn against you when you know you're going for God and you're rooting for God and doing what's right in God's eyes. So if I were to wait for my family, I would not be in church. I will not be in church. So you do what God calls you to do, coming out of your heart, you're doing the right thing. And you fall and you pray and hold onto God's hands. He will guide you. He orders our steps. He has ordered my steps, you know. And trusting him over time has brought me a mighty long way. And he blesses me. He will show you. He will bless you when he's guiding you. He never takes you the wrong way. He orders your steps. And I'm a strong believer in that.
I'm in the chat and I got a couple of comments. Sister Ursel says, God calls us as we are not qualified so that he can show us through him all things are possible. And he gets all the glory when we accept the invitation to join him along with his work. And then Sister Ann says, he equips who he calls. Thank you all for your thoughts. So, Brother Lane, I'm going to ask you to walk through this next slide with me. I'm going to read it, the bullets, and then I wanted to get your thoughts. Brother Lane, are you there? Just give me a sound check.
I'm here.
All right. God knows how to bring salvation to your family, your friends, your community, and your world. He looks for people who will allow him to shape them into the instruments he requires to do his divine work. He can mold us into whatever instrument he requires. All we need to do is be present, available, full of the Holy Ghost, and full of wisdom. Brother Lane, what are your thoughts on those bullets?
I think they're all very compelling. The first one, God knows. You can stop there.
God knows.
Right? God knows. You can just stop there. It knows better than sometimes me, my friends. Sometimes better than people at church, right? God knows.
My Lord.
And I love the fact that, you know, like I think someone said, he equips us. And that's what I think the second bullet point is about, is that, you know, us allowing him to shape us to do his work. I know you all had a meeting on servant leadership, I believe, before I joined. Like me, myself, I'm getting involved in ministries, and I just want to help. I look at this point to be more of a follower than a leader. I think good followers become great leaders. And then he molds us, and I believe over time he will mold me into what he wants me to do at Mount Olive Baptist Church. I don't know what that is right now. I'm putting my hands in different things and getting a feel and meeting you all and, you know, growing and learning. And my vision is not as big as God's, right? None of us, our visions are as big as God. So he knows what I'll be doing at Mount Olive 4 years from now. Or 10 years from now. I have no idea. I just, you know, I see next Sunday, you know, I see the Sundays in next month in September, but beyond that, I don't know. I don't have the detail, the all knowing that God has about what I'll be doing 4, 5, 6, or 10 years from now. And the one I love the most is the last one, because I think it's the simplest and possibly the most, it doesn't require you to think a whole lot. Right? It's just said, just be present, be available, be full of the Holy Spirit in prayer, and be full of wisdom. Okay, maybe wisdom requires some thinking. But for the most part, it says, you know, show up and come with, you know, the love of the Holy Spirit. Come with good godly intentions, which may not be humanly, right? And then I believe that he will give you the wisdom. And you, where you're lacking, you know, you will learn from others. Like, I mean, I learn a lot. I love listening to, you know, people on this Bible study talk and teach, not just talk, but teaching. So I love all the conclusions. I think they're all compelling, each one. But my favorite one is the last one. When all fails, be present, show up, be available, you know, come with the Holy Spirit and come with wisdom, or God will give you wisdom. So those are my thoughts. I love the conclusion. I think it's a very good chart.
Thank you, sir. I want to check in.
And also, thanks for not calling me while I was eating dinner. I just knew you were going to call me while I was eating dinner. I'm going to turn my phone off. Luckily, I had finished. It was close.
It was good timing. So I'm gonna ask for some thoughts from one of my dear mentors in the Word, Reverend Rome. And Reverend Rome, Brother Lane said, you know, these things look pretty simple, especially the last one. Don't have to do too much thinking. Just got to be present. Reverend Rome, as you look at these bullets, in your experience, are they always easy for people to accept and reflect?
From my experience, the answer would be no.
And what keeps people from accepting and these tenets and just being present in your experience?
Because we are who we are as humans, there's always something going on in our mind. So being present is not always easy. We got to learn how to block out the distractions and all of those things so that we can be present to hear God, to know God, and to join Him at work. We also have to make ourselves available for God. God don't have to chase any of us. We have to be available for Him. He knows where we are. He knows our number, our street, and all of that. And when He knows, because we have been seeking Him, as Matthew says, He knows our availability. And so when we are available for God, He will invite us to join Him at work, because the ultimate goal is salvation to mankind. And we want to save as many people as possible, family, friends, enemies. We want everybody saved, that they may enjoy eternal life. And when it says full of the Holy Spirit, as we begin the Acts study, the one thing that God, that Jesus told them, don't move until I give you the Holy Spirit. God's Holy Spirit is present with every believer, because it's that thing that seals us and keeps us. But we have to also allow that Holy Spirit to work in us and empower us to do things God's way and not our own way. Because then when we do things our own way, we're in danger of someone not seeing Jesus. And the ultimate goal is to see Jesus. Wisdom don't come like talking about it. James said, I think it's in the book of James, with all thy getting, get understanding. And when we look at Proverbs, it talks about wisdom. We're not going to have wisdom without the power of the Holy Spirit, because our wisdom is finite, but God's wisdom is infinite. And we can take that wisdom to help others see Christ, accept His invitation. And it's not always easy to accept God's invitation to join Him either.
Yeah.
Sometimes that invitation will shake you up depending on what He's asking. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you need Him to just be patient with you so that you can say, why not me?
I can't do better than I got nothing else. I got nothing else. I did want to play you all a video, and then I'm gonna open it up for some any other questions. But you know, one of my, you know, as I was growing up, one of my favorite action stars is Bruce Lee. And I am the type of person that, you know, if I have an affinity for something, I go all in. I'll do deep research on the type of person, you know, what their belief structure is. Do those things align with mine? You know, I don't believe in just, you know, being a fan or thinking, you know, aligning myself with somebody just because. But this is a video that Bruce Lee did years ago. I'm going to play the video and then we'll discuss, and then we will move to close. So here we go. Hopefully it plays.
Empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
So the reason why I play that video, and the reason why that impacts me so much, is because sometimes when God calls us, when He invites us into service, we have such rigid ideas about who we are and what we're supposed to do. We're so rigid in those thoughts and opinions about who we are that sometimes it prevents us from walking in the way that God would have us to walk, and to serve in the way that God would have us to serve. If I am a writer and God asks me all of a sudden to start climbing mountains, then my vision of myself doesn't match. And so therefore, the doubts and the distractions and the misappropriation of energy comes in. But if I can just be formed, if I can just be open-minded enough, be flexible enough, allow myself to kind of flow with the Holy Spirit, if I can just be connected with God enough, if I can work on my relationship with God enough, then I know that when he invites me to do something, that he's got it all worked out and all I got to do is move. That there's no situation that he can put me in where I won't be able to lean and depend on him to get through the situation. So I'm going to pause. Comments, questions, thoughts, please, from anybody.
Brother Farmer, excellent job. Excellent job. I just wanted to comment. Everybody said some really good points. Sister Aputa, she made something that stuck in my head. And along side of that, with the water parable, you know, sometimes we get stuck in religion and we think we have to do church this way. This is how we do church. This is how we do church. And when we're outside of the four walls, we do church like this. But if God is love, he's calling us to be fluid so that wherever he calls us, we're able to conform to that situation. And not only that, but when we're so rigid that we can't bend, God can't really use us. And one of the reasons why God called, we say, the unqualified, which I don't necessarily believe that statement. I think he prepares us, as Brother Glenn was saying, prepares us through life. So when he does call us, we are already prepared to do what he's called us for. But sometimes he has to show us that we're prepared. Like Gideon, you got to tell me a couple of times. But when we're fluid enough to move like God has requested us, then like Sister Aputa said, there's no hesitation. I don't care what anybody else said. I know God called me. I know I never wrote a book before, but I'm going to start writing tonight.
Amen. Amen. Anybody else? Any other thoughts?
Hey, good evening. This is ministry, and I was able to get back with my husband. I was sitting. I loved the lesson. The beginning portion of what you spoke about, this is what came to me when you talked about the invitation and the invitation that God gives us to salvation, right? And then to accept the invitation, the RSVP, our response, by accepting that, then that indwelling of the Holy Spirit comes because Jesus has left and we have the Holy Spirit. And the event is how we go about our life in relationship with him, yielding and trusting to the fact of what he will do for us. No, we're not. Are we equipped? Do we know? No, but he equips us. And so it's stepping outside of ourselves, yielding to that, trusting him, walking with him along this life's journey to do his will. And that will is to help to build the kingdom, because this is just a passing through area. This is not our home, but it's how we conduct ourselves. I am blessed, truly blessed by the lesson tonight. So thank you.
Amen. Bless you. Bless you. I see.
Go ahead.
No, who was that? Oh, go ahead, Sister Buddha, please.
Yeah, I was looking at this song and it says that God does not compel us to go against our will. He just makes us willing to go. I love that song. He does not compel us, but he just makes us willing. So what we're going, God has a way. I don't know how to explain it. He has a way that helps us to submit to his will. It's not up to us. God is always in control. It's not up to us at all. So he doesn't compel us. He makes us willing to go.
Amen. That's, amen. That's what I Thank love, you yeah. for that. I see Sister Word on, and I will be blessed, Sister Word, if you gave us a thought on the lesson before we close. And I'm gonna wait real patient till you find that mute button. Sister Word? You're not off mute yet. Okay,
can you
now
hear
you
me
gotta
now?
Say everything. Now you got to say everything all over. Yes.
Okay. I was saying that I came in very late because I just really just kind of been getting into the system because I wasn't able to get in because of a power problem here. So I didn't really hear too much what anyone was really saying to comment. But one thing that just kind of struck me was when that last on the clipping that you have when you had Full of Wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't sure about that because I don't know. I have to think a little bit more on that. Yeah, just fair. Give me some time. Give me some time.
Fair enough. Mm-hmm. Fair yeah. enough.
Mm-hmm. Can I say something about wisdom?
Please, mm-hmm. yes.
Since the word Proverbs 4:7 says, wisdom is the principal thing. Mm-hmm. Therefore, get wisdom. And with all that getting, get understanding.
Right.
So wisdom actually comes from God.
Yes.
And if we don't get wisdom from him, then our wisdom is just, that's not what it ought to be. We will lead people in the wrong way.
Amen.
And for the person who talked about equipped, Ephesians says, God put gifts in the church and people like pastors and teachers in the church
yes.
to equip his
yes.
saints.
Mm-hmm.
Until we all come into the full Amen. Knowledge of Christ.
Totally so, agree with you.
Yes, Amen. I totally agree with totally that. Agree. Yes. Yes, I totally agree with that. Yes.
So anybody else? Yes, please.
Pull me back if I go too far. I'm gonna try to like just go like halfway out on the bridge.
Okay.
But
I won't let you go in the water.
No, right? No, this is I'm not gonna cross the bridge. You'll understand
right.
what I said. But Reverend Rome, I really appreciate what you said because it really helped me. I don't watch presidential debates because I know who I'm voting for. But I do watch conventions, even though it's not the convention of my party, because I want to hear what they're saying. And I was just so surprised how many times I heard the word God and Bible. And I even heard the majority House Speaker say that party is the stands for God. And it wasn't until you said that, you know, that wisdom comes from God. And I realized that possibly what people were saying last night when I listened to that wasn't God's wisdom. There was some humanly thing that I was hearing. So I really appreciate you saying that because I was struggling with how many times I was hearing things attributed to God from that particular convention. I'm smart enough to know that at some point people were using many, many hundreds of years ago, they were using the Bible to justify slavery. I get it. I totally get it. So they can use it just for everything they're doing now. So anyway, I'm going to come back because I was going across that political bridge. I'm going to come back to this side. But thanks for being a safe space so I could say that. And
bless
not
you.
Trying to
bless
get
you.
Our discussion to go some other way. But what Reverend Walm said about wisdom coming from God, it really helped me understand what was happening.
And Reverend Rome also, Reverend Rome also talked about how we have to be wary of distractions. We got to be careful about those things that distract us from focusing on that relationship and continue to grow that special bond we have with God. I heard somebody else. Somebody else had a comment.
Deacon Farmer, this is
yes, ma'am.
Helene.
Yes,
I listen to everybody. I thank God for, first of all, using everyone on the line. But I thought about what Minister Hill was saying. Yes, God, you know, he knows the first thing is you put that thing up. God knows he calls us, then he equips us. But the main thing I was looking at is that even though he equips us, we have to get in a position and go, and then be obedient, and God will provide. He's going to provide, but there are some things that we have to do. And I think one of sister and I was talking this week, you know, when they say God provides for the birds, but he never built that nest in it. The birds had to go build that nest in it. So God give us the knowledge. Think about it. He said he provide for the birds, but the birds went to build a nest. Think about it. And then he provides the knowledge, but wisdom. But then there's a word also said that those that think that they are wise, let them become a fool that they may become wise. And that's what the brother was saying. I watched some of it myself, and they were taking the word of God out of proportion and use it to their own use. But yes, he equips us, but we have to get in a position. And first of all, I thought about the first invitation when he told us to come, you know, in Matthew 11:28, that was on my mind. So when he said, come, he just want us to work, rest. He said, take my yoke and learn of me. Then I thought about after that, when he teaches us how to rest, that's when we come in discipleship, the other invitation, because once we rest and leave it up to him, then we become his disciples and doing what he say. Doing the last one is that we can be in a realm to live with God. You know what I mean? To be obedient. But first, regardless, the word is here, but we got to study to show ourselves approved, divide the word between right and wrong. But the word is there. The word is always there. It's going to be there, but we have to position ourselves to be obedient, commitment. You know, we can talk and we can say this, but when it does happen, Reverend Ron was saying, it's not easy, because we think it's easy, but it is easy, but it's what we want to do at the present time. So I just wanted to say that.
I appreciate you.
And I do believe that, I do believe that wisdom, again, does come from God, but no doubt, but it comes from really studying his word.
Amen.
You understand? Mm-hmm. The more you study and rest yourself down into the word of God, he starts giving you revelations according to the uncompromised word of God.
Amen.
And once he starts giving you that revelation, and he's dealing with you on those terms,
amen,
then you'll start progressing more, and he'll start showing you what the mystery of his word is.
Amen.
And
amen.
Then that's when wisdom comes in. That's how I see it. That's
amen.
Wisdom comes in there really from studying the word of God and God dealing with you so profoundly, until he starts giving you various revelations of the word that you are reading. And then after he gets you, I feel from my experience, that's when he starts dealing with me, showing me what the mystery. It is something about the mystery of God's word. It takes you real deep. It takes you deep. And it really does. It takes you deep into the word. But it doesn't take you so deep into the word where it's all just about you. He takes you deep into the word where you're pulling others into the word, and they're actually seeing exactly what's being said in the word of God. On different, you know, it could be a child, it could be different ones, but it's just, I just have to say, once you start reading the word and God starts giving you revelations of his word, then he starts dealing with you. It was the mystery of the word of God.
Amen.
And also, Deacon Farmer, it's like, to my experience, when God started dealing with me with things, he would deliver me from that, take and put me back in the same place, and so I can bring others out.
Yes.
And that's what I'm saying, because that he does that, because a lot of time he'll take me through a lot, and sometimes the very thing that we speak of to tell somebody else, God is telling us that.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of time we be trying to tell other people's things. You know, I'll give you a good example. There's times that my son would do something, boy, I hated it, but then God began to show me that was in me. The very thing sometimes that you hate, that's the thing that God is trying to tell you to get right in you, but sometimes we're too close to the mirror.
Yeah, remember, he lives in you. He lives in you. You are never the same He changes you. Like you say, he molds you. You are never the same. He lives and dwells in you. He directs all your actions. He guides you. When you have God, your life changes completely. You are not the same. And when people see you, they ought to be able to see God in you. That's what makes you who you are, a child of God. He dwells in you. He lives in you.
The thing too, once God starts dealing with you on that level, it's very, very important that we keep humility in our hearts. We keep the love of God in our hearts, and we keep humility in our hearts, because that's how we're going to draw other people to him.
Other people, yeah.
You don't want to see, you know, it's nice to be smart and to know different things, but how you deliver the different gifts and things that God gives you, that's how we draw more people to him.
You all made me think. Most invitations, when you receive them in the mail, they have plus one. So my last challenge to all of you is that when God does extend that invitation, who are you going to bring along with you? Mm-hmm. Who are you going to bring along with you in the Word? That's all I have for the evening. I want to thank everybody for their input and their participation. Thank you for being patient and offering grace to me. And the current slide has what the lesson is going to be on next week, which is Speak Lord. That's reality 4, I believe. And you can find that sermon on YouTube. If all hearts and minds are clear, I'm going to ask Minister Ann Hill to pray us out.
Okay, thank you. Father God, we come before your presence, Lord, just to give your name all the glory, all the honor, and all of the praise. We are very grateful for how it is that you moved in this study tonight. Thank you for our facilitator, those who put things together, and even those who had contributing words. But as we leave this lesson tonight, Lord God, not from your presence, but impart this word upon our souls, upon our mind, and in our spirit, Lord, so that we might delve even deeper into what it is that you want us to receive. Amen. What you want Amen. Us to receive, what is imparted Amen. In each of us, so that we collectively Amen. To come about to do your work, oh God. We Amen. Are grateful, Amen. God, grateful, yes. grateful, grateful, grateful yes, for every household thank you, thank that you. Is represented on Hallelujah. This.
Lord, thank you.
God, yes, be Lord. In the midst, Lord God. Stand yes, watch Lord. In the doorways, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Name Our congregation Jesus. As a whole, Father God. Our yes, congregation, sir. Our pastor, Lord yes, God, sir. You have a work for us to do.
Hallelujah.
You have a work for us to do. So help us to hear yes, spiritually, sir. Not yes, just sir. Naturally. Help us Hallelujah. To see spiritually, yes, not just naturally. Thank and then you. Set a guard over our tongue, God, so yes, that sir. We might speak and praise your holy name. Out, Hallelujah. Not just our homes, God, not just on our workplaces, God, but in the community, wherever it is that you decide that you are Hallelujah. Sending us. This is your work, oh God. We pray, Lord God, that you are pleased with what was done here tonight. Thank we you, thank Lord. You. We yes, praise Lord. You. We give you yes, glory. Lord. We give you honor, for it is in your name, Jesus Amen. The Christ, I pray.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen. God bless you all. Amen. Have a wonderful evening.
Amen. Thank you, Deacon Thank Farmer. You. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you,
Deacon
Farmer. Thank you, Deacon
Farmer. May God bless all of you all. God
bless you all.
Thank you.
Bless you all.
Thank you,
everybody. Thank you, sisters and brothers. I love
Good
you all.
Everybody.
Be blessed.
Thank you.
Love you.
I see you, family. I see you, family.
To God be the